All right, so now that we've collected our ADCP measurement, we're gonna wanna do a quick Bankside review before we leave the site to make sure we've got a good measurement. So the way that I like to approach this is to look at the components of discharge. So that's area and velocity, and if we break down area to width and depth, then we can evaluate the depth, the width, and the velocity. And if we're happy with all three of those, then we should be happy with our discharge value. So I like to always start by reviewing the depth. So what I'll do here is I'll close the summary section of the bottom of my screen just to give myself a little bit more real estate space. So Control S will do that. And then Control S would bring it back if I wanted to look at the summary. So what I'll do here on my transect tab, I've got bottom track depth plotted on one axis, and then I've got vertical beam depth plotted on the other. And what I like to do is double click on the axis so that I can select manual, and then I set the min and max of the axes so that as I flip from transect to transect, they aren't adjusting the axis and I can just look at the bottom profile. So we'll go from zero down to about, 1.4, and that should give us enough space. And then I'm gonna check the box for mirror scale on other axis, and so that way the bottom track depth and the vertical beam depth will be on the same scale. All right, so now that I've got that set up, I will start reviewing my depth. And what I'm looking for are erroneous points and sections of missing data. So I've got both track reference or both depth references to choose from. So if one does miss a sample, I can always select the other one. And it actually, in the M9 and the RS5 software, they will fill in for one another if there is a missing depth value. So let's take a look. So I'm looking at my first transect here, and it looks like we've got data all the way across from both references. That's great. We'll notice there's a little dip over here on the left side, so we'll just kind of pay attention to that and see if it exists in the other transects. So let's look at transect number 2 here. This one also consistently has data all the way across from the bottom track beams, which is in red. The vertical beam depth here is in black, which looks like it did have some missing samples on the vertical beam, but that's okay because bottom track depth will just fill in for those missing samples. So we'll take a look at our next transect, transect number 3. And this one actually looks like we've got depth from both references all the way across, so that's great. Take a look at transect number 4. This one looks to have consistent data all the way across from bottom tracking again, and then a small section of missing data from our vertical beam, but not a problem. Bottom track depth fills in there. So looking at transect number 5, we've got depth all the way across. That's great. We've got a little bit of missing from the vertical beam, but again, not a problem. And then finally, we'll look at our last transect, number 6. And it looks like we don't have any missing data from our depth references, so that's fantastic. So deciding between one or the other, that's always the question. The vertical beam is a dedicated echo sounder, so it's looking directly down, which will give you a little bit better resolution of what the bottom looks like. The 4 bottom track beams are actually giving you an average depth of the 4. So as you approach a shallow section, you're going to be using an average of those. And so it's actually gonna smooth the bottom out a little bit more. So when you can choose the vertical beam, choose the vertical beam. And in this case, we didn't have any erroneous points from our vertical beam. So we'll leave that as our default, which is what we selected before we started the measurement. If we did have any erroneous points in vertical beam, then we would wanna switch that transect to bottom track. And I'll show you how to do that. So to bring up your track references, you can click Control 1. Sorry about that. That's actually gonna bring up your site information. Control 2 will bring you into your system configuration. And this is all available from the tool, from the toolbox, which you can access from Control T for toolbox. And you'll see in the bottom section here that we've got our vertical beam selected for depth reference. That's what we chose before we started the measurement, and so we're just going to leave it there. But if you needed to, you could switch it to bottom track by just toggling on the menu. And then if you wanted to do that for all of your transects, then you would just hit the apply to all and then click OK. But we're going to leave it with a vertical beam because it did a good job of defining the bottom. And when it did have a few missing samples, bottom track is just automatically going to fill in there. So that's good. So we've got consistent depth all the way across. So that's critical, because if we didn't have depth, then we couldn't calculate area. And if we can't calculate area, we don't have Q. So that's good. So we've got depth. So the next thing we'll look at is width. Width is actually calculated from the track reference. And it is the DMG, distance made good, which is just the straight line from your start point to your end point, plus the edge distances that you've entered. So it's just arithmetic of edge distances plus the DMG. So when I'm reviewing this, I'll bring up the summary window. So I'll go Control S. That will bring up my summary on the bottom portion of my software. And then I'll look in here and I'll look at the width. And I'll also look at DMG, since that's directly impacting my width. And I'll also make reference to my right distance as well as my left distance. We kept those consistent the whole time, so they didn't change. And when I'm looking at this, I'm looking to see that it's consistent and repeatable. And it looks like we've got a mean of 23.5 meters for width, and we've got a COV, which is a coefficient of variance, for our width of 0.003, which is very, very good. So we've got very consistent widths, which makes sense because we've got this strung to a tagline. And as we are collecting the data, we felt very confident in our track reference. If you're not sure if your width data are correct, if you're not sure how to assess this, the best way is to have like a third-party reference. So if you're out here with a laser rangefinder, you can easily grab the total width with that. If you're working from a bridge, you could measure with a tagline. And then you could also measure out the rope as you bring it back and pull it off the line. So there's a couple different ways for you to kind of verify that the width that was measured by the ADCP is in fact correct. So again, we got the 23.5 meters width here, and that was very consistent with our track reference that we've chosen. And we were able to verify that with a laser rangefinder, and we feel very comfortable with that. And width, in this case, is coming from our GGA track reference. So if I bring up Control 2 again, we'll see that we have GGA selected for our track reference. So that is how we're calculating our width. So depth is good. Width is good with GGA. So next up is velocity. And this is going to be calculated from the track reference. So the best way to evaluate your velocity data would be to look at your actual velocity tick marks here. Make sure that they are reasonable, that you've got velocity vectors pointed downstream. You basically want to make sure that nothing looks abnormal for what your site conditions are. So we'll just go through each of these transects and actually look at our velocity vectors here on the transect tab right in the middle. So if we start with our transect one, we've got both our bottom track and our GGA on here. And so what I'll do to just make it a little bit easier to look at our velocity data is I'm gonna turn off bottom track. So I just right-clicked in that track reference view, and I'm gonna uncheck bottom track. So now all I'm displaying right now is my GGA track reference. So I'm just looking at my track, looking at my velocity vectors, and making sure that it looks reasonable for the site. And we've got these long velocity vectors because we're at a very swift moving site here today on the Blue River. So this first transect looks good. We've got good velocity vectors all the way. Our second transect looks pretty consistent with our first. We don't have any strange looking vectors pointed upstream. For transect number three, we've got very similar velocity vectors. They're, again, showing about the same magnitude as our previous ones, so that looks good. They're all pointed downstream in a consistent way. So we'll just take a look at our other transects here. They look very consistent and like our other ones, so that's good. Looking at transect five now, again, looks very similar to the previous. And then looking at our last transect, looks very consistent with the previous five. The other thing that's going to impact your velocity data is if you have beam separation. And beam separation is when, typically when you have cavitation or bubbles that form on the face of your transducer, and then you'll actually see separation of one of your beams in this bottom SNR plot in the bottom left-hand corner. And I'll show you an example here because we've got one. So we actually had three beam separation samples on our last transect. Three samples with beam separation is not a big deal. It's when you have consistent beam separation, if you have nine or more, that's going to be a problem for your velocity data. So just to show you what it looks like, I double clicked on this QC warning over here. It also then showed me where in the transect that is on the bottom. And now I get to see that sample here on the bottom left. I see my SNR plot, which we can clearly see that all these beams are starting to separate out. If I double click somewhere else in the transect where I don't have one of these yellow squares, where I have no QC warnings, you'll see what a typical SNR plot looks like, where they're all kind of hovered together, and then you'll see a bottom reflection as they reflect off of the bottom. So we'll check our QC window on all of our transects to make sure that we don't have excessive beam separation. And this is actually something that as you're collecting the data, you should really be looking out for, because you can't make any post-processing changes to overcome this. So it is something that we were looking for as we collected the data. So I'm very confident that we don't have any instances of nine consecutive beam separation samples in a row. But we'll just double check just in case. So I'm just looking through the QC window on each of these transects. I see a handful of beam separation samples here. But you have to keep in mind there's 215 samples on a single transect at this measurement site. So a handful is not going to make any difference, really. So I'll just check my other transect. So looking at number two here, I've got another handful, but they're kind of spaced out, so that's fine. I can also, if I wanted to investigate a QC warning, I can double click in the transect of the color map on the bottom, right where I see one of those yellow squares. And then it's gonna immediately bring me to that sample. It'll highlight the QC warning in the QC window so I can tell, oh, okay, that one had beam separation. So I'll just continue on and look at my other transects here. Just make sure, again, that we don't have excessive beam separation. Again, just a handful on that transect, which kind of makes sense considering how rough the water surface is. Great, so transect four just had a couple. Transect five only had two. And then transect six only had three. So that's great. So I'm feeling very confident about my velocity data. I've reviewed to make sure my SNR is good. My velocity vectors look normal. So at this point, I've looked at depth, I've looked at width, and I've looked at velocity. So I'm confident with my Q number. But before I actually look at that number, I'm going to run my data through Xtrap, which is actually a USGS developed tool. This is going to use the data that I collected to extrapolate the top where we're not measuring, and then the very bottom where we're also discarding data. So our default is to discard the last 10% of the profile. So there's that 10% at the bottom that we're going to need to fill in with velocity data with an extrapolation. So the default is theoretical, and that's just using a power law, and that works generally fine, but in the real world, you don't always have power law theoretical velocity profiles. So we're going to launch up this Xtrap tool, run our data through, and then actually select our extrapolation method for the top and the bottom. So we go into discharge settings here, Xtrap method, and now it's taking all of our data. You can see this velocity profile here in the center. And then over here in sort of the bottom right, you'll see the different types of extrapolation methods for the top and bottom. And it's going to bold the extrapolation method that it recommends. So it's recommending a power fit here. However, the exponent is not the standard 0.1667, which is the theoretical. Instead, it's recommending a different exponent that's about twice that value. So we'll just go ahead and double click on that. Apply to all. And now I'm ready to actually look at my Q value. So I'll hit Control S, bring up my summary. And then down here, I'm going to be looking at total Q and looking at the mean, which is 38.79 cubic meters per second. And we've got a coefficient of variance of 0.18, so that's 1.8%. So that's really good. Anytime I see a COV of less than 0.05, I'm pretty happy that all those transects were very consistent. So I'm happy with this measurement, and I can now pack up my gear and go home.